Good afternoon to you all. Please be seated. My name is Victor Adams. I am the local Anglican priest here at Margaret's, and we want to wish you warmly welcome here at the funeral service of Judy, and trust each one who are present here with us today, God's blessing and peace during this time of your grief with Judy's passing, particularly so the children of Judy, the wider family. We want to extend our sympathy and condolences with your mother's passing. Not so long ago, we had Jimmy being buried from this church, Judy's brother, and so to the family indeed, we pray for your peace at this time of your loss. So on behalf of us here at St Margaret's, we want to welcome you each, especially those who follow on live stream the service. We pray that you will feel as much welcome at this service today as we are, as we come to celebrate the life of Judy and give thanks to God for a beautiful life lived here in our community and amongst us. And today, as we come together to thank God for Judy's life, as we also come to mourn her death, we are reminded that God is her maker and he has called her home. We come together to see how her mortal body will be laid to rest, as we fully know that death is not the end, but that death is the resurrection. As Christians, we believe that those who die in Christ will indeed share the eternal life with him. We therefore come together in faith and hope that after death, one day for us all, we will be in the presence of the Almighty God. I invite you to pray with me the prayer from the service sheet. Let us pray. Loving God, you alone are the source of life. May your life-giving spirit flow through us and fill us with compassion, one for another. In our sorrow, give us the calm of your peace. Kindle our hope, and let our grief give way to joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Scripture readings today from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3. For everything there is a reason, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What do we gain from all our work? I know the heavy burdens that God has laid on us. He has set the right time for everything. He has given us a desire to know the future, but never give us the satisfaction of fully understanding what he does. So I realized that all we can do is to be happy and do the best we can while we are still alive. All of us should eat and drink and enjoy what we have worked for. It is God's gift. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Following that reading, we have St. John chapter 14, the Holy Gospel, chapter 14, verse 1. "Do not be worried and upset," Jesus told them. "Believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I'm going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how can we know the way to get there?" Jesus answered him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me." "Now that you have known me," he said to them, "you will know my Father also. And from now on, you do know him and have seen him." For the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have some spots here. If those standing in the back want to grab a seat, you're welcome here for seating. Dear friends, it's an occasion where we are somber about Judy's passing, and we feel with the children and the wider family the loss of a dear mother. But we also are mindful of the many memories, as we will see with the pictures later on, that Judy leaves behind for us to hold on to embrace, to remember from here forward. The word remember is such a beautiful word because it has the word member and the prefix re. And I thought that when we, in a big family like that wonderful family as they are, that each one is a member. Judy was a member. And so that would go for all of us, wherever clans we're coming from and wherever families we belong to. But it's when one is no longer there that that place is empty. And that space is then filled up by memories. And we remember the stories and the tales and the beautiful things that person had done. And so today we will hear stories. Today we will reflect on Judy's life. And that today for us brings us to the reading of Ecclesiastes. And it's attributed to Solomon, King Solomon, whom we know was the wisest person to live. And being a son of King David, he had seen a great deal of things in his life and gathered a great deal of information. And so when we read the book of Ecclesiastes sort of twice and thrice, you understand that Solomon actually not only observed what was happening around him, he actually studied. He studied the wind, the trees, how the sun comes up and goes down. Solomon was particular and meticulous about how seasons work, how creation work, how people's minds work, how relationships work. And we find that sort of in pockets as we read the very short book of Ecclesiastes. Speaking about relationships, in chapter 3, Solomon wrote about the union of two wonderful people when they come together in matrimony. And Solomon says they are tied like a rope, but a three-cord rope. And the third of that cord is God, that string them all together. And it's such a beautiful analogy for marriage. But Solomon had looked at that in his community, in his society, and came to those pillars of wisdom. In chapter 12 of Ecclesiastes, Solomon speaks about the youth growing up and becomes as great pillars in the community. But then he's quick to say, hey, don't forget your Creator, because youthful days runs out. And then we have to stand before our Maker at the end. In chapter 6 of the book of Ecclesiastes, there is this beautiful imagery of Solomon looking at ants on the ground and see how they gather food and store them in little holes. And he compared that with us human beings, that we gather and store, but food in particular for the winter times. And when the winter times, the ants are gone in their holes, they are safe, their food, they are warm. And so Solomon said, well, there's something that we do as well. But God cares also for that little ant. I remember when I spoke to the family of Judy about Jimmy's funeral a few months ago, the many beautiful stories in their family home. And this reminded me again, you were 16 children? 16 kids, yeah. That's a rugby team, and the referee as well, or the coach added to that. But a beautiful stories of those formative years, sitting around the table, sharing great childhood memories of those years, and the wonderful example of mom and dad. And Solomon takes us to a place like that to remember, to be a member, but to remember where we come from which cloth we are cut, from where we had grown up, from where we hail. It's so easy today to start one's life, or rather go into life itself, and lose your identity, who you really are. And so Solomon says, well, let's think of it this way, that there's a time to do everything that we can, a time to be born and a time to die. God had ordained for Judy and for us a time to come into this world, but also one day to leave. And in the spectrum of this life, we have to make life count. We have to make it worth a while. Not the way that we want to, but the way that leaves a mark when we are not there anymore. That while we have today, we have a good shot at loving someone, at sharing peace, at making peace. While we are here and have breath in our lungs and have the things that Ecclesiastes speaks about, the wind, the sun, life itself and the Creator God, we have a golden opportunity, seems like, this time that he's talking about, to make it work. There are a few words of time, as we know, and two comes to mind. It's the word chronos, chronological order in succession. And our life is like that. We are born, we grow up, and we live as children, become teenagers, etc. And we one day get married and get older. The trajectory of life happens in the chronos. But then there's another word that sort of falls right into that, is the word tetelestai, a Hebrew word that means now is the time. This is the time. This is the season that I fully comprehend and fully embrace that which God has made my life to be. Solomon ends this beautiful reading today from Ecclesiastes 3 that says that all of that we see and have and receive, four. It is God's gift that God has gifted us with this life. And while we have this life in this period and season, we have to make it worth a while. I hope we will go from here, both you as this wonderful family as you are, and us as the community, to make this season, this time from birth till death, this time from planting till harvest, this time from coming till we leave, a time and a season for us to reach our full maximum potential in appreciating what God has given and love being a member where we are as a family member or a husband or a wife or a child. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Dear friends, we call now for Maureen and Pauline. Pauline will do the eulogy. And after them, Cooper will follow with the eulogy.
So those who don't know me, I'm actually one of the eldest nieces of Judy. So in the Slattery household, Judy was the third child of the late Albert and Jane Slattery, sister to Florence, Betty, Irene, Billy, Teddy, Brian, Helen, Noel, Pam, Maureen, James, Cheryl, Karen and Louise. They spend a lot of time together, especially the older girls, before the youngest and brothers come along. Most days were spent at home as they weren't allowed out of the house without a parent or relative, except for Sundays, and that was to attend church. On their way, the first stop was to Grandma's for a clean handkerchief, money for the church plate, and Gran to make sure they had all had clean shoes. But I was told at the weekend that there was a certain male that didn't used to put the money into the church thing. Hey, Billy. Judy, her sisters and brothers would walk to get school together as the girls were not allowed to walk by themselves, and apparently they walked miles. The boys would often sneak away, leaving Judy and her sisters by themselves to make their own way to school. Judy left school at the early age and started working at the Gold Cross shoe factory with her other siblings. As a teenager, Judy was allowed out, of course, with sisters and brothers, to attend dances, movies and the church group. Judy's sister Irene said this was where they met up with the boys and snuck a few kisses without the boys knowing. As Judy grew older, she started dating guys with cars, and on one occasion finding out the hard way that she'd been driving around in a stolen car. After Judy married and had children, her home was always open to her sisters and brothers to join together for a catch-up, quick cuppa, and most of the time staying chatting at the house. Our sister Judy may not always be at our side, but she's always in our heart.
Judy Slattery, with an IE, married Charlie Fitzpatrick in 1963, and they had three children, Darren, Darlene, Corey, as well as fostering two children, Billy and Linda. Mum was a strong and stubborn person when she had to be. In 1982, Billy became ill and required constant care. Mum cared for him at home for as long as she could. Unfortunately, in 1985, Mum's world was turned upside down. Billy passed away, her mother Maud passed away, her mother-in-law Lila passed away, and by the end of the year, her marriage had ended. Her strength got her through that year. Throughout the years, Mum had various jobs, from working at the golf club, grading fruit at Pete Puller & Co., where she thought Philip was gorgeous. Her last job was doing childcare in her home, which she loved. It was nothing to get out of bed in the morning to find the house full of kids having all types of fun. It even got to the point to have a conversation with Mum. We had to call her Judy so she would answer us. Mum had a habit of saying, actually, and all of the parents started wondering why their children were saying, actually. Mum wanted her children to start their own families so she would have grandchildren to spoil. She nearly didn't get to meet them after going into a diabetic coma. Thankfully, she survived and thrived and ended up with six grandkids. As many of you know, Mum was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and in December 2017, she moved into Otteray. She kept the staff there on their toes, especially after doing a Harry Houdini and getting out of the lodge on a couple of occasions. Her sense of humour and quick wit kept the staff entertained throughout her time in Otteray. Mum was loved by so many because she had this need to take care of people and nurture them. Her caring and nurturing was something that she continued to do while residing at Otteray. We thank you for being here today to help celebrate Mum's life. We will all miss her smile, sense of humour, and the ability to make us laugh. The last thing Mum wanted us to know was that she loves us. We love you, Mum.
Nan, we will forever cherish all of the memories of the times we spent together, such as Christmas, birthdays, and having family meals. Nan's favourite meal, which was also the staple diet in her household, was crumbed fish, potato gems, and veggies. One of her favourite things to do was go for walks and pick bits of plants from other people's garden beds and take them home and stick them in a pot plant, hoping they would grow. You couldn't walk out the back door or the front door without tripping over a new pot plant. They were everywhere. Her love for gardening was inspirational. And when she invited us over for tea, or she came to us, she would spend half an hour in the garden. She always liked going out for coffee with family, and she always knew it was a cappuccino and a blueberry muffin. You never had to ask. She loved her dog, Molly, and they were never far apart. Sometimes Molly would even sit in the chair with her, pretending she was a human. Her love and compassion was never unnoticed. She inspired others to be better versions of themselves. You could never make it up the street with her without stopping more than five times to speak to someone she knew. She nearly knew everyone in town. She was always a joker and had a smile on her face no matter what. Her favourite joke that she always used was, "Do you want to hear a dirty joke?" The boy fell in the mud. There is so much more that could be said, but there isn't enough time. Thank you for being the best Nan ever. We will love you, Nan, and we will miss you. Love you forever and always, your grandkids.
I just wanted to start by thanking everyone for coming today to celebrate Nan's life. I wanted to begin by sharing some special memories that my family and I have shared with Nan over the years. Growing up, we would stay at Nan's while Mum and Dad went away somewhere. She would always cook us party pies and noodles for lunch, take us to Macca's for tea, and hot Milo's and Bickies for supper. Now, that doesn't sound quite simple, but they always tasted amazing. And I think it was made more special because I think it was time spent with her. A couple stories Sam wanted to tell included Nan trying to convince him eating certain foods. The first such instance is telling Sam that if he eats his vegetables, he will grow up to be as tall and strong as Dad. However, for those of you who don't know Dad, he would never eat vegetables. So Sam brought this up and she had a chuckle. Another time, Nan told Sam that he had to eat his peas. He absolutely refused. So Nan told him if he wanted to eat dessert, he would eat his peas. So Sam still stubbornly refused out of hatred for peas. Last Wednesday, to celebrate Nan's life, Sam ate his first pea in a very long time. To this day, he still hasn't eaten another. Amber and Ali appreciated Nan hosting special sleepovers for them and Brooke growing up, and how much mischief they would always get up to, always walking everywhere with Nan and Maureen and visiting all different people from different walks of life. Mum and Dad remember all the times that Nan used to come with them to watch all of us kids participating in sports, school events, and other activities, just being there to always support us. We will celebrate every birthday with a passion fruit sponge, her favourite. Dad also remembers Nan playing dress up with us kids and how it always made her happy. My favourite memory of Nan was when I was about 15, 16, 17 and working at the bakery. I hadn't been able to see Nan as much during the last few years and I was missing seeing her. Anyways, one day Nan and Maureen came into the bakery. I was allowed to go sit down with them and talk about what had been happening in my life and what my family had been up to recently. So every time Nan and or Maureen would come in, I would take my break and spend it sitting with them, and I really appreciate this time together. A few days after Nan had passed away, I called my old venture leader and his wife, Claire, to have a chat. I found out Claire's mother had not only been in the same lodge at Autrey as Nan, but she was the room right next to her. Claire told me every time she went in to see her mother, she would see Nan and say, "Good morning / afternoon, Judy Fitzpatrick." Nan would always smile and laugh and say hello back. It just reminds me how bright and happy Nan was and how much she loved each of us. The last thing I wanted to finish on is a memory from when I was about 7 or 8. I was out in the backyard and Nan was watching. It was nighttime and there's a lot of stars out. She told me that all the stars are people who'd passed away and they live on and watch over us from up above. I find it's a comforting thought. It helps remind us that while someone may have passed away, they will always live on through us and are always watching us. So I want to say my final goodbye. We've all loved the time that we spent together, and I hope to see you in the next life up in the stars.
Gracious God, whose Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, We thank you today for Judy's life, that you have granted her to live with the family and in our community. We thank you today for granting her the gift of eternal life with the passing from here. Merciful Father, we pray for Judy's family, for her children, remembering her, embracing all the beautiful things she stood for and shared with them, and the legacy she leaves behind. Dear Lord, be with them, uphold them in your mercy and in your love, and give them each day the assurance that your constant care will be with them. Give them courage to face the future without her, knowing that you will carry them and even reunite them once again in the life hereafter in time to come. Lord, we honor Judy's life today, but more than that, we honor you who gave her to us as a mother, a sister, and a dear friend to us all. May your dear soul rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. We share together in the Lord's Prayer from your service booklet. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we come to a point in the service where we sprinkle the coffin with holy water, which is a sign of our baptism. In the waters of baptism, we died with Christ and begin to walk in newness of life. May we, with Judy, all the baptized, be brought into the fulfillment of God's kingdom. Judy, go forth from this world on your journey. In the name of God the Father, who created you, in the name of God the Son, who suffered for you on the cross, in the name of God the Holy Spirit, who strengthened you on your journey. And now into the communion of all the saints, aided by the angels, archangels, and all the heavenly hosts, may your portion this day be in peace and your dwelling in the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen. In conclusion, dear friends, I invite you to pray with me. Let us entrust Judy to the mercy of God as we pray together. Holy and loving Father, by your might and power, you gave us new life in Christ Jesus. We entrust Judy to your merciful keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, who died and rose again to save us, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit. Glory forever. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto her, Lord, and may light perpetual shine upon her. For the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Judy, may God's light shine on your way as your season from this world is completed and God receives you warmly in his kingdom. Amen. We have come to the end of our service and call the coffin bearers to the front for the song, Achy Breaky Heart, to play us out.
Please stand.